Good morning to all. Today we are going to study third lesson of geography part, climate, soil, natural vegetation and animals of Karnataka. In this chapter we learned climate, variety of climates in the state, reason for the diversity in the climate and its features, soil, types of soils and formation of the soil, meaning of natural vegetation, types of natural vegetation and last topic is the animal resource of Karnataka. Now let me explain first topic of this lesson, climate. What type of climate is there in Karnataka? Karnataka has a tropical monsoon climate. What are the features of tropical monsoon climate? Tropical monsoon climate consists of hot and moist summers, cool and dry winters. Means during summer season, climatic condition will be very hot along with the humidity. Moist summer means along with humidity, there will be a very high temperature in the state. And during winter season, temperature will come down and land will be dry. Means humidity will be low, land will be dry and weather will be very cool. So these are together called the tropical monsoon climate. We have tropical monsoon climate in our state. But in same climatic season, we can see different types of climates in various part of the state. Because variety of geographical location or different geographical location, due to different geographical location, there is diversity in the climate of the state. You can, for example, during summer season, some part of the state having high temperature, it will be more than 40 degrees Celsius also. But at the same time, Malnad region and neighboring districts of Malnad region recorded a low temperature. Why? Because of forest area in this region. But here in northern Maidan region, there is no forest area like Malnad region. Due to lack of forest region, here it records highest temperature during summer season. So that means this is only called a different geographical location. Some parts are having ocean, some parts are having evergreen forest, huge mountains, but some parts are plain Maidan region. So due to these all different geographical location, annual temperature and distribution of rainfall also not same all over the state. Climatic season of the state divided into four parts over a period of 1 year. They are summer season, rainy season, period of retreating monsoon and last one winter season. Now let me explain first climatic season, summer season. Period of summer season from March to May. What are the features of summer season? See, main features of summer season are hot, dry and sultry. During summer season, whole Karnataka experience a very hot climatic condition. Land will be dry. What is sultry? Sultry means it's a mixture of high temperature and humidity called sultry. So these are main features of summer season. As I told you, March is the beginning month of summer season. After March, temperature increase all over the state. When it reached to May, temperature recorded highest in the state. Until today, Raichur has recorded highest temperature in the state, that is 45.6 degrees Celsius. So it's called hottest place in Karnataka. Not only Raichur, along with Raichur, its neighboring districts means other northern Maidan districts also recorded highest temperature in the state. Why? Because told you already, because of due to lack of forest region. Due to lack of forest region, northern Maidan only records highest temperature and lowest temperature also. If you take humidity, humidity is lower in northern Maidan than southern Maidan. Humidity is lower in southern Maidan than humidity is lower in northern Maidan than southern Maidan. Why? Because of this reason, northern maidan receives low rainfall. Always rainfall required high temperature and more humidity. But northern maidan has high temperature, not humidity. Due to this reason, northern maidan receives low rainfall in the state. But during summer season, due to great evaporation, Karnataka receives rainfall. What is evaporation? Evaporation means water. What water is there on Earth's surface? No. Moving upwards and joining with clouds. Later, these clouds only will bring rainfall in this region. So, due to evaporation process, Karnataka receives rainfall when during summer season also. But it required humidity along with the temperature. For example, coastal region and Malnad region has more humidity than southern and northern Maidan region. That's why coastal and Malnad region receives heavy rainfall every year. So this rainfall is called convectional rain. Rainfall during summer season is called convectional rain. It will come along with lightning and thunder. This rainfall occurs especially during afternoon time due to high temperature. Sometimes we can see hailstones also falling down in some places. Hailstones means rainy water falling down in the form of ice cube called hailstones. So this conventional rainfall is also called mango showers and cherry blossom. Why? Because this rain is helpful to flowering of coffee plants and it is helpful to grow mango crops also. Because of this reason it's called cherry blossom and mango showers. And during summer season, I told you already, Karnataka receives rainfall, but not highest. Karnataka receives only 7% of rainfall. 7% of the annual rainfall of the state during summer season. Look at here, this is the picture of summer season. Here you can observe, land will be dry, high temperature is there, along with some parts are having humidity also. Look at here, this is the picture of humidity and this is the evaporation process. Water is moving upwards in the form of gas and joining clouds. Later, same clouds will bring rain in same region. Now, let me explain second climatic season of the state, rainy season. Period of rainy season from June to September. Rainy season is also known as southwest monsoon winds. Why is it called southwest monsoon? Because during rainy season, wind which is blowing from southwest to northeast. Winds blowing from southwest to northeast direction. Means in the western part of India, we have Arabian Sea. So winds which is blowing from Arabian Sea towards northeast. By the time it will bring rainfall in Karnataka also. So Karnataka receives highest rainfall during rainy season. That is 80% rainfall. Karnataka receives 80% of rainfall during rainy season. It's called southwest monsoon winds because of winds blowing direction. Winds blowing from southwest to northeast. While wind blowing from southwest to northeast, winds are restricted in Western Ghats. Why? Because Western Ghats means it has huge mountains and evergreen forest. This mountain and evergreen forest, it will restrict winds which is blowing from Arabian Sea. Resulting, Malnad receives heavy rainfall, more than 120 centimeters rainfall when during rainy season. After Malnad region, exactly behind of Malnad region, there is Eastern Maidan region. But Eastern Maidan will not receive heavy rainfall. Why? Because before that only, Malnad will restrict those winds blowing from Arabian Sea. That is why Eastern Maidan is called rain shadow area. Eastern Maidan region is called rain shadow area. Why? Because which is located exact behind of rainy area, means Malnad region. In Karnataka, Agumbe is an area of heavy rainfall. So it's called the Chirapunji of South India. Why it's called Chirapunji? Because Chirapunji is a Meghalaya state. So Chirapunji is one of the heavy rainfalling area in India. Like that only, Agumbe is one of the heavy rainfalling area in South India only. That's why it's called the Chirapunji of South India. After Agumbe, Vagamandala and Hulikala, so second heavy rainfalling area in the state. But Nayakanahatti near Chinnakere in Chitradurga records every year lowest rainfall. Chitradurga part of Maidan region, so it required receives the lowest rainfall every year. What are the features of rainy season? See, during this season, if you think temperature will be low, means it is wrong. Always, I told you already, rainfall required temperature and humidity. That's why temperature is very high and humidity also high. As a result, rainfall also more in the state. And we can see clouds also on sky. And during this season, Karnataka receives 80% of rainfall. And it helpful to grow kharif crops. Kharif crops means those crops growing during rain season called kharif crops. So this rainfall is helpful to grow kharif crops in the state. Now let us go to third climatic season, period of retreating monsoon. Timing of this season, October and November. It continues only 2 months. But after rainy season, during retreating monsoon time, Karnataka receives the second highest rainfall. There is 12% of rainfall. So this season is also called the Northwest monsoon season. Why? Because during this season, winds, it will change its blowing direction. Before, during rain season, winds blowing from southwest to northeast. Now it is blowing from opposite direction, means from northeast to southwest. Why this changes occurs? Due to decrease in temperature and increase in pressure. Due to this reason, winds blow from northeast to southwest, and it brings 12% of rainfall for the state. These winds are dry because which blow from land. That's why it will not bring more or heavy rainfall in the state. But sometime winds blowing from Bay of Bengal. Bay of Bengal located in eastern part of India. So that's why those winds, it will bring rainfall where in southern Maidan regions. Why? Because these winds are passing through southern Maidan regions of the southern Maidan districts of the state. While blowing in, while passing in this region, it will bring rainfall in those region. So along with the rainfall, we can see cyclones also during a period of retreating monsoon. Due to this cyclone, weather condition will be uncertain. Uncertain means it will not remain same. Sometime there will be heavy rainfall, sometime we can see sunlight with high temperature. So it will change from time to time. So it's called a uncertain weather. So this is about a period of retreating monsoon. Now let us go to last topic, last climatic season, winter season. Period of winter season from December to February. So here we can see what we studied in previous topics, no? Rainy season, summer season and period of retreating monsoon. Here we can study exact opposite features of a previous climatic season. Why? Because here temperature will come down, humidity will come down, rainfall also low. During this season, temperature, humidity, rainfall, all three are low. Because why rainfall are low? Because of why rainfall is low? Because of temperature and low temperature and low humidity. As I told you, rainfall always required high temperature and humidity. But here, temperature will come down, at the same time, humidity also will come down. Its result, rainfall also low and sky will be clear. There will be no clouds like rainy season and period of retreating monsoon. And in this season, temperature is recorded, average temperature is recorded 25 degrees Celsius to 27 degrees Celsius. And in the month of January, temperature will come down, completely it will come down. And January month is called the tourist month of the state. Why? Because of very cool weather, it attracts a number of tourists towards the state. And minimum temperature recorded in Belagavi is 6.7 degrees Celsius. What we studied in highest temperature recorded in Rayachur, part of Northern Vaidar. At the same time, least temperature also recorded in one of the Northern Vaidar district, Belagavi. This is why, because of lack of forest region in this place. If it's a forest region, by the time it will not allow to increase or decrease temperature. But here, due to lack of forest region, sometime same Northern Vaidar region records highest temperature and it records the least temperature also. Along with Belagavi, other its neighboring districts of Northern Vaidar region receives records low temperature. Rainfall during winter season is minimum. Karnataka receives only 1% of rainfall during a winter season. And early morning we can see fog. Early morning we can see fog also. So these are features of a winter season. Look at the picture of winter season. Here you can observe fog in the early morning. So this is about the climatic season of the. Now let us go to second topic of this lesson, soils of Karnataka. There are many types of soils can be seen in our state, but mainly soils of Karnataka divided into four groups. They are red soil, black soil, laterite soil and coastal alluvial soil. Now before going to study types of soil and formation of soil, we have to know what is soil. Generally might have seen soil, but there is a particular meaning of soil. What is soil? Top thin layer of the earth surface is called soil. There are many layers in earth surface. Among that, top layer is called soil. What are the uses of soil? Soil is using for a different purpose. Mainly, agriculture required fertile soil to produce any types of crops. Now, let us go to types of soil. First one, red soil. Let us study how red soil is formed. Red soil is obtained from weathering of granite and is obtained means created. Red soil is created or formed from the weathering of granite and gneiss. Here you have to observe word weathering. What is weathering of granite and gneiss? See, due to rainy water, due to extreme temperature, due to wind, stones will change its original form and it will convert into small pieces, or it will convert into soil. Finally, it will convert into soil. So this process is called the weathering process. Due to rainwater, extreme temperature and due to wind, stones will change its original form and it will convert into soil. This process is called weathering. So here red soil is formed due to weathering of granite and gneiss. Granite and gneiss, both are types of soils can be seen in Karnataka. Look at here, this is a granite type of stone. This is a gneiss, another one type of soil. Due to weathering these two soils, red soil is created. So this red soil contains iron oxide. What is iron oxide? Iron oxide, one of the chemical compound. So red soil contains iron oxide. Iron oxide in red color, that is why red soil also in red color. And it also contains iron, lime and salt. These three are not chemical compound, mineral compounds. Iron, lime and salt, three are mineral compounds. So So it is there in a red soil. And red soil, one of the very light soil. Very light and thin soil. But that's why this is not fertile soil. That's why red soil is not fertile soil. One more reason is there. Why? Because it contains a small amount of humus in the soil. What is the use of humus? See, when there is humus in any soil in a huge amount, by the time those soil will become a fertile soil. Example, black soil. Black soil contains more amount of humus. That's why black soil is one of the very fertile soil among the four types of soils. But red soil contains a small amount of humus and very light soil and very thin, it consists of very thin layers. That's why its capacity for moisture retention is very less. When there is humus in any soil, by the time it can retain or it can keep water or moisture for a long time. But when there is a small amount of humus, by the time its capacity of moisture retention, it will come down. So that's why red soil is not most fertile soil, because its capacity for moisture retention is very less. Why? Because of due to small amount of humus in the soil. So these types of soils are widely distributed in southern districts of Karnataka, like Bangalore, Mysore, Mandya, Chamarajanagar, Chikkaballapur, Kolar, etc. These all are southern Maidan districts. And in these types of soils can be grow different types of crops like ragi, jowar, bajra, millets, pulses, tobacco, and types of vegetables also. So ragi, you know that ragi is one of the main food crop of southern Maidan region. Can be grow because of red soil. And areas with irrigation facility can grow paddy, sugarcane, potato, vegetables also. Where there is a irrigation facility, can we grow paddy, sugarcane, potato and other vegetables in this soil. Why? Because along with red soil, some crops required water, more water facility also. That's why if it's an irrigation facility, can we grow paddy, sugarcane. Mainly both are required heavy rainfall or more water. So this is about the red soil. Next, let us go to second type of soil, black soil. One of the most fertile soil in the state. Why? Because it contains more amount of humus. Black soil is also called black cotton soil. Why? Because can we grow cotton in this soil? Cotton required black soil to grow. That's why black soil is also called black cotton soil. So this kind of soils can be seen in northern part of Karnataka. Means in northern Maidan regions are having a black soil. So these types of soils are formed by the weathering of basalt rocks. Black soil formed weathering of basalt rock. Look at here. This is the picture of basalt rock. So weathering of this rock, black soil is created. And black soil is rich in aluminium, magnesium and oxides of iron. Hence it is in a black color. So these are chemical compound, aluminium, magnesium and oxide of iron. So these all are in black color. That's why black soil also in a black color. Why this is called fertile soil? Because its moisture retaining capacity is more compared to other soil. It will withhold moisture for a long time in the soil. That's why this is called fertile soil, most fertile soil, because it contains humus in a huge amount. Variety of crops can be grown in the soil. They are cotton, jowar, maize, sunflower, chili, paddy, pulses and onion, and other types of vegetables also. So these types of soils can be seen in northern Medan districts like Dharwad, Gadag, Ballari, Koppal, Kalaburgi, etc. Now let us go to third type of soil, laterite soil. This kind of soil is found in area which receives heavy rainfall and high temperature. You know that in Karnataka, Malnad and coastal region receives heavy rainfall. At the same time, temperature also is there in the same place. So, laterite soil found in Malnad region and some part of coastal region also. So it contains four types of chemical compounds like lime, silicate, aluminium and iron. But these four are divided into two groups. First two are lime and silicates. Why divided into two? Because first two, lime and silicates, are called water soluble chemical compounds, because easily it can dissolve in rainy water and settle down in the lower layers of the soil. But next two are there, no, iron and aluminium, which are called non-soluble. It will not melt even soil. That's why it remains in the top layer of the soil. This soil will become soft during rainy season. But during summer season, same soil will become very dry and it creates laterite rocks. During rainy season, it will be very smooth and in the form of soil. But during summer season, it will change its form and it will become very dry and it will create laterite rocks. So this laterite rock is using for a construction purpose mainly. And different types of crops can be grown in this soil like cashew, coffee, tea, cardamom, pepper, rubber, coconut, etc. These all are major commercial crops of Malnad and coastal region. As I told you, Malnad and coastal region having this type of soils, Uttara Kannada, Udupi, Dakshina Kannada, Kodagu, Chikkamagalur, Shivamogga, these are all districts along with Belagavi also, some part of Maidan region also having this type of soil. Look at here, this is the picture of laterite soil and this is a laterite rock. Same soil, it will convert into laterite rocks when during summer season due to temperature. Last one, coastal alluvial soil. This type of soil is formed along the coast due to the deposition of alluvium and sediments carried by the rivers and sea water. This soil form due to this type of soil is created by sea waves and sediments carried by rivers. So this is the mixture of sediment and sea waves. So this type of soils can be seen in mainly coastal districts. That's why it's called coastal alluvial soil, because it required sand also. Sand which is carried by sea waves. So this type of soils can be seen in coastal districts like Udupi, Dakshina Kannada and Uttara Kannada. And this soil contains sand and clay. It's a mixture of sand and clay. It's very rich in organic nutrient. After black soil, one more second fertile soil. And in this soil can be grow paddy, cashew, coconut, arachnid, banana, etc. These all are major crops of coastal region. So this is alluvial soil, mixture of sand and sediments carried by river. So this is about soils in Karnataka. Let us go to last topic of this lesson, natural vegetation and animal resource of Karnataka. Let me explain first natural vegetation. Before going to study types of natural vegetation, we have to know what you mean by natural vegetation. What is natural vegetation? Various kinds of plants and trees growing naturally referred to natural vegetation. That means various kinds of trees and plants grown naturally, not grown by human beings, called natural vegetation. That means in this topic we are not only studying about types of forest. Along with that, grassland and shrubs are also part of natural vegetation. Not only forest, along with that, grassland and shrubs are also part of natural vegetation. Next, what are the uses of natural vegetation? Let me explain one by one. First one, natural vegetation plays a significant role in preserving the ecological balance. Means, maintaining temperature in the environment. Ecological balance means maintaining temperature in the environment. Where there is a forest, those regions will maintain average temperature. Why? Because of forest region. Take example of Malnad region and Northern Maidan region. Malnad region having average temperature for a whole year. But Northern Maidan region records highest and least temperature. Why? Because due to lack of forest in this region. Second one, those trees available in forest region can be used for timber works. Timber means woods using for a construction purpose. And we can use for a firewood, raw material for industries. And we can use as a medicinal herbs, honey, bamboo, cane, etc. Third one, forest being the habitat of wild animals. Wild animals used to live in the forest region. That's why it became a habitat of wild animals. Fourth one, these forests are also place of entertainment and tourism. How it became a spot of entertainment and tourism? Because of greenery. It attracts a number of tourists towards this place. So that's why it became a spot of entertainment and tourism. Fifth and last one, they help to control environmental pollution. Forest region or natural vegetation helps to control environmental pollution. In the forest of Karnataka, can be seen special type of tree called sandalwood. And Karnataka is known as the land of sandalwood. Why? Because Karnataka is one of the leading producer of sandalwood trees. And Karnataka is one of the leading supplier of sandalwood trees to various parts of the world. Can be prepared perfume, different types of soaps, we can use as a medicinal herb also. So these are use of sandalwood, and it has more demand in various parts of the world. And Karnataka is one of the leading producer, that's why Karnataka is known as the land of sandalwood. Now let us go to types of natural vegetation. First one, evergreen forest. How evergreen forests are created? Area which receives more than 250 cm rainfall annually having this kind of forest. That means this forest required heavy rainfall and high temperature. We know that Malnad region, especially central part of Malnad region, receives heavy rainfall and it has high temperature also. That's why this type of evergreen forests are located especially in the central part of Malnad region. It required a heavy rain and high temperature. What are the features of this forest? It has a very tall trees and it is very dense. What is dense? Number of trees gathered in one place called density. So these trees are very tall and density also one of the feature of this forest. How density means sunlight does not reach at ground surface. Sunlight does not reach ground surface. So this much density will be there inside the forest. And impenetrable means difficult to reach inside because of density of this forest. So this is called evergreen forest. In this type of forest can be seen types of tall trees like rosewood, mahogany, keynote, teak, dupa, hepparasu. These all are prominent trees can be seen in evergreen forest. And at the base of these trees are thick shrubs. Means, look at this picture. Lower part of these trees having or surrounded by thick shrubs. So this is one of the feature of evergreen forest. Along with tall trees, can be seen types of spices also in this forest, like cinnamon, cardamom, cloves, and some other medicinal herbs also can be grown in this evergreen forest. And I told you already, central part of Malnad region has this type of forest, like Shomoga, Hasan, Chikkamagalur, Kodagu. These are located in central part of Malnad region. Along with that, some part of coastal region like Dakshina Kannada also having this type of forest, and Uttar Kannada, Chamarajanagara also having a evergreen forest. Look at this, is the picture of evergreen forest. You can see very darkness is there inside the forest because of density, and trees are grown very tall. Second one, deciduous forest. How these type of forests are created? A place receives 60 to 120 centimeter annual rainfall, created a deciduous rain forest. And after winter, due to lack of moisture in the soil, trees shed their leaves. Leaves will fall down due to lack of moisture in the soil, and leaves reappears during spring and created a deciduous forest. You can see the picture of deciduous forest here. Look at here. This is the picture of a deciduous forest. After winter, due to lack of moisture in the soil, trees are fallen down and leaves are fallen down, and leaves again reappears during a spring time and created a deciduous forest. These types of forest can be seen in Chikkamagalur, Mysore, Chamarajanagar, eastern part of Hassan, Tumakur, Chikkaballapur, and southern part of Kolar. Why? Because these forests are not located in exact central part of Malnad, because it doesn't require a heavy rainfall. 60 to 120 cm rainfall enough. So those regions receive 62 to 120 cm rainfall, created a deciduous forest. In this forest can be seen types of trees like teak, kino, mahogany, neem, mango, jack, flame, coco. Among these, few are repeated from evergreen forest. And special feature of this forest, these forests are not dense. Look at the picture of deciduous forest. Trees are not gathered near one by one. So distance is there from one tree to another tree. So that's why here these forests are not dense like evergreen forest. Third one, mixed forest. How these types of forests are created? This is the mixture of deciduous forest and evergreen forest. Evergreen forest and deciduous forest together created mixed forest. And area receives 120 to 150 cm annual rainfall having a mixed forest. And these kinds of forest can be seen in Udupi, some part of Uttar Kannada, Dakshina Kannada, eastern part of Kodagu, Chikkamagalur, Hasan, Mysore, etc. in west part of the Karnataka. And in these types of forest can be seen types of trees like teak, kino, mahogany, axel, and one of the special type of tree called sandalwood. Sandalwood tree can be seen in especially mixed forest. And jack, bamboo, other trees of this forest. And one of the special feature of these trees are having commercial value. Why? Because these trees are using for a trading purpose or commercial purpose, using for a exporting purpose. Look at the picture of a mixed forest. This is also not dense because the trees are not gathered near one by one. So distance is there from one tree to another tree. And this is not a density. This is not a dense forest like a evergreen forest. Fourth and last natural vegetation, grassland and shrubs. As I told you in introduction part, natural vegetation means not only types of forest. Grassland and shrubs are also part of natural vegetation. Because grassland and shrubs are grown naturally. So, natural vegetation means not only trees. Along with that, small plants are also part of natural vegetation. That's why fourth type of natural vegetation is called grassland and shrubs. How this type of natural vegetation created? Area receiving less than 60 cm annual rainfall having this type of natural vegetation. That means due to scanty rain and dry weather, due to lack of rainfall and dry weather, it created short grass, thorny shrubs and scrub vegetation. It created short grass, thorny shrubs means mullina podegalu and scrub vegetation. Small type of small group of plants gathered in one place called scrub vegetation. So this type of vegetation can be seen in especially northern Maidan region, and we can see type of grassland called grassy slopes. Grassy slopes means grassland located wherein slope region can be seen in mountains of Malnad region. So that means here area receives below 60 cm annual rainfall created grassland and shrubs. So in this place can be seen types of thorny shrubs like cactus, acacia, babul, bela, palm trees. Along with that, occasionally can be grown neem trees, pet people trees, banyan trees, etc. And this type of vegetation can be seen in northern Maidan districts like Bidar, Kalburgi, Yadagiri, Rayachur, Vijayapur, etc. Along with grassland and shrubs, can be seen one type of forest called mangrove forest. But distribution of this type of forest is very limited. Why? Because mangrove forest can be seen in the coastal region of Karnataka. Why? Because deltas, estuaries, beaches of coastal region created mangrove forest. What is deltas? Look at here. This river, surrounding area of this river called delta, having type of vegetation. And estuaries means when river going to join sea, this part is called estuaries. And this deltas and estuaries created, and some central part of rivers also created mangrove forest, or it's also called Kandla Kadgal. Special feature of this mangrove forest, in other forests can be seen roots of trees located under soil, but here roots of these plants located under water. So this is special feature of mangrove forest. And this is the shrubs or podegalu. And what I told, two types of grassland. Here you can see left side of this picture, this one grassland located in a plain land. Second one, this one also grassland located where in slope region. So this is called the grassy slopes, especially located in mountains of Malnad region like Kudremukha here and all. Along with mangrove forest, Shola forest can be seen in some part of Karnataka. What is Shola forest? Both side of rivers can be seen forest, or rivers are passing through forest called Shola forest. And area which are more than 1400 meters above than sea level having grassy slopes. So this is about types of natural vegetation. Now distribution of forest लास्ट टॉपिक इन नेचुरल वेजिटेशन डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन ऑफ फॉरेस्ट मीन्स हाउ मेनी परसेंटेज फॉरेस्ट एरिया इज देयर इन कर्नाटका. कर्नाटक हैज 43.4 लाख स्क्वायर किलोमीटर फॉरेस्ट रीजन विच इज इक्वल टू 22.6% ऑफ द टोटल जियोग्राफिकल एरिया ऑफ कर्नाटक. And in India, Karnataka occupies 7th position regards to forest region. And in Karnataka, Uttar Kannada district has maximum forest area. It's after other Malna districts like Shivamogga, Chamarajanagar having a good number of forest areas. And last place goes to Vijayapur. Regards to distribution of forest, Vijayapura district has least forest area. So this is about types of natural vegetation and distribution of forest area in Karnataka. Now let us go to last topic of this lesson, animal resource of Karnataka. Very small topic. Karnataka has a variety of animal resource and Western Ghat is called World Heritage Center because of its greenery and its special structure. Its UNO has declared Western Ghat as a World Heritage Center. And we have 25% of animal population and 10% of tiger population in our state. And there are 5 national parks, 4 bird sanctuaries and 17 wildlife sanctuaries. These bird sanctuaries and wild animal sanctuaries, it will protect birds and wild animals. Along with that, national parks also. In national parks also can be seen wild animals. But what's the difference between national park and wildlife sanctuaries? National parks are mainly it's a plain land. Can be seen both domestic animals and wild animals in one place called national park. But wild animal sanctuaries means where there is evergreen forest or dense of forest created as a wildlife sanctuaries, or where there is a number of wild animals called wildlife sanctuaries. So this is the picture of a bird sanctuary, one of the most prominent bird sanctuary of Karnataka, Ranganathittu bird sanctuary. This is a wildlife sanctuary, and this one of the most important national park of Karnataka, Bandergatta National Park, located in Malnad region. So this is a national park. So this is about animal resource of Karnataka. So in this lesson we studied types of natural vegetation. Then before that, types of climatic season, types of soils of Karnataka, and it's after natural vegetation, and last we studied animal resource of Karnataka. Thank you.